Yeah, thank you very much. So it's a pleasure to be the second talk at the second day of the second conference in the second year of the pandemic. And thank you very much to the organizers also for giving me the opportunity to come here to Bonn. So I'm really now in Bonn and I like this very much. So I will speak about four papers which I've written with Feifmann and Solanes. And we generalize some notions from the Euclidean, respectively Riemannian case, to the pseudo-Euclidean and pseudo-Riemannian case. And so I will start by recalling things from the Euclidean case. So you all know Steiner's formula. So you take a compact convex body K and then you look at the tubular neighborhood of radius T around it. And then it is well known that this is some polynomial. And the coefficients, if you normalize them correctly, they are called intrinsic volumes. So intrinsic volumes are valuations, which means that they are finitely additive. And we have seen this notion. Actually, I don't know if this notion appeared really in Franz's talk, but functionals which he had in his talk were clearly also valuations. So the mu k, the coefficients in this Steiner formula, these are valuations. Moreover, they have some particular properties, namely they are invariant under Euclidean motions. And more generally, one can consider the valuation which maps k to the volume of k plus a, where a is some fixed convex body. By val, I denote the space of continuous and translation invariant valuations, and continuity is with respect to the Hausdorff topology as usual. Then we have the famous Hattiger theorem, which says that the space of all continuous and Euclidean motion invariant valuations has precisely the intrinsic volumes as a basis. So in particular, it is finite dimensional. I just wrote down some names of people who contributed to the theory of valuations, in particular to algebraic structures on the space of valuations and to classification results. And some of them are here in Bonn, at least virtually. And probably I forgot to put some names. So if you don't see your name and you feel you should be there, don't be offended by it. So let me now come to the Riemannian case. In this case, there is something which is very similar to Steiner's formula, which is called Weyl's principle. And for this, we take some compact submanifold in some Euclidean space. And we look again at the volume of the R-tube around it. And this time we have to assume that the radius is not too large, because otherwise there can be self-intersections of the tube. And for small enough r, this will not be the case. And since the volume of the tube is again a polynomial in r, and so coefficients, they are called intrinsic volumes of m. And what is particularly nice about these intrinsic volumes is that they only depend on the inner metric of the submanifold and not on the particular embedding in the Euclidean case. And this means that you can define them on any abstract Riemannian manifolds, because an abstract Riemannian manifold you can always embed into some Euclidean space. Moreover, these coefficients, which are just real numbers, you can extend them to be so-called valuations on manifolds. And for this, one uses Alesko's theory of valuations on manifolds. I don't want to go into details, but the main point is that these are functionals which are defined on a suitable space of tame subsets of M. So for instance, you can take sets of positive reach inside M, or subanalytic subsets of M, also are some other choice like differential polyhedra. And then these mu k are such valuations on M. Moreover, what is also very important is that whenever you have some isometric embedding of Riemannian manifolds, so you have one Riemannian manifold M inside some larger Riemannian manifold tilde M, then you can take the intrinsic volume of the larger manifold and you can restrict it to the smaller manifold, and then you obtain precisely the intrinsic volume on the smaller manifold. So in the Euclidean case, this would correspond to the fact that the intrinsic volumes are independent of where you consider your convex set. You can always, if you take a convex set in some Euclidean space, you can consider it in some larger Euclidean space, and then the intrinsic volume will be the same. And this phenomena is called Weyl's principle. Just two small examples. So the zeros of the intrinsic volumes is just the Euler characteristic on M. And the last one is just the volume. And so then some other, like the N minus second one is related to the total scalar curvature of the manifold. Now, let us look at some particular manifolds, namely space forms. So we look at simply connected space of dimension n and of constant sectional curvature sigma. So depending on the sign of sigma, this will be a sphere of convenient radius or Euclidean space or hyperbolic space. And then we look at the space of totally geodesic subsets of a fixed dimension n minus k. And we can put some invariant measure on it. So invariant with respect to the isometric group of the space. And this measure should be suitably normalized. I don't want to go into details on this. But then we have the following Crofton formula, which says that if you take Euler characteristic of the intersection and you integrate over all totally geodesic subspaces, then you obtain some linear combination of intrinsic volumes. So for instance, if sigma equals zero, then we are in the flat case. And in this case, on the right-hand side, there is precisely one intrinsic volume which appears. And on spheres and hyperbolic spaces, there is this linear combination on the right-hand side. There are many applications of this formula. In geometry and topology, so for instance, in knot theory, there's a theorem by Fahry and Milner and versions of it, which are based on the spherical Crofton formula. But there are also many applications outside mathematics, for instance, in stereology, microscopy, and other things. Okay, so this was a very short review of the Euclidean and Riemannian case. And now I want to go to the pseudo-Euclidean and pseudo-Riemannian case. And I want to ask the question how much of this theory works in this case. And the short answer is, well, all works, but there are some technical difficulties, and we also should add the word generalized wherever we can. So you will see later by what I mean. Of course, the long answer is much longer, and this is based on four papers with almost 200 pages, and there are a lot of technical difficulties to solve, and I will just give you some overview of the results. So first of all, what is pseudo-Euclidean space? Well, that's it is just vector space, and it is endowed with a quadratic form with a fixed signature, but the signature is not supposed to be Euclidean, so it can have a signature PQ, and P and Q may both be positive. So a standard example of such a quadratic form is what is given here. And the isometry group is then called OPQ. Now, one of the difficulties is that the isometry group, if P and Q are both strictly positive, then this isometry group is no longer a compact group. And this poses a lot of difficulties. One can nevertheless define the space of OPQ invariant, continuous and translation invariant valuations. But it turns out that this space contains only very few elements, namely in degrees 0 and n. So these are Euler characteristic and volume. They are still invariant under this larger group OP, or under this different group OPQ. And moreover, there are some elements in degree n minus one. And otherwise, there are no such valuations. So this is somehow a disappointing fact. But one can, instead of looking at continuous valuations, one can look at so-called generalized valuations. So there's this theory of generalized valuations, which was initiated by Semyon Aleska. And I don't want to give you the precise definition, but you can think of generalized valuations as a particular case of valuations that can only be evaluated at smooth enough convex bodies. So for instance, if you take smooth convex body and you project it onto some hyperplane, then you take the volume, you will obtain a function on the space of hyperplanes. And if the body is smooth, then this function will be smooth and you can apply, you can integrate it with respect to some measure, but you can also apply some distribution to it. So you can at some place use derivatives of this function. And then you obtain something which you can evaluate on smooth bodies, but maybe not on all bodies. And if we look at these generalized valuations, then the theory becomes rather parallel to the Euclidean theory. Namely, it was first observed by, shown by Aleska and Feifman in the Lorentz case, and then later in the general case by Feifman and myself, that for each k, there is a complex valued intrinsic volume. And these complex valued intrinsic volumes, and their, more precisely, their real and imaginary parts, they span the space of all generalized valuations which are invariant under OPQ and translations. So this can be seen as a version of Hartwiger's theorem in the pseudo-Euclidean case. So if we want to see the real beauty of Hartwiger's theorem, we have to go to generalized valuations in this case because there are only few continuous valuations. Now, the next step is how to extend this to pseudo-Riemannian manifolds. A pseudo-Riemannian manifold is a manifold with a non-degenerate quadratic form. And since the quadratic form has some fixed signature, PQ. And it turns out, so this is recent work by Feifman, Solanis and myself, that for each pseudo-Riemannian manifold, we can construct complex valued generalized valuations mu k, which satisfy Weyl's principle or a version of Weyl's principle. Namely, whenever we have an isometric embedding of one pseudo-Riemannian manifold into another, since k's intrinsic volume of the larger manifold, when restricted to the smaller manifold, is precisely the k's intrinsic volume of the smaller manifold. And I should mention at this point that here there can already be some mixture of signatures. For instance, you can take the intrinsic volumes on Rn1. So this is a Euclidean space of signature n, 1. And inside it, you find the usual hyperbolic space, which is of signature n0. And so if you take the intrinsic volumes of this larger pseudo-Euclidean space and restrict it to the hyperbolic manifold, you will obtain precisely the usual Riemannian intrinsic volumes. And so you can go, you can pass from one signature to another using this, these embeddings. I should remark that the generalized valuation on a manifold, it is as before, this is something which can be evaluated at somehow smooth enough things. So for instance, at generic domains with smooth boundary. Nevertheless, there are some technical issues here. Because in general, the restriction of a generalized valuation is not even defined. And but in this case, one can show that this is possible here to define the restriction to a smaller manifold, and then this restriction is the intrinsic volume of the smaller manifold. Now there's also something which I call inverse Weyl principle, which is again some kind of Hardeker theorem, some kind of classification theorem, which says that whenever we have such a thing as intrinsic volumes, namely something which associates to each pseudo-Riemannian manifold a generalized valuation, such that the Weyl principle holds, then phi will be a linear combination of the intrinsic volumes and their complex conjugates, or real and imaginary part if you prefer. So in other words, the intrinsic volumes are the only valuations which satisfy Weyl principle. Now, what about Crofton formulas? Well, first of all, we have to define some kind of spheres and hyperbolic spaces. And in general, a complete connected pseudo-Riemannian manifold of constant sectional curvature. This is called a space form. And the three main examples are the pseudo-Euclidean space of signature PQ, which I have already defined. Since there's a pseudosphere of signature PQ, which consists of all vectors of given strictly positive norm. So this will be the pseudosphere, which in general is not a compact manifold anymore. And the particular case is the so-called De Sitter space, which is a Lorentz manifold. If instead of a positive radius, we take a strictly negative radius, then we can define the pseudo-hyperbolic space of signature PQ. And the particular case is anti-De Sitter space, which is also a Lorentz manifold. And basically, these are all space forms up to taking covers and connected components. Okay, so now we have these versions of spheres and hyperbolic spaces, and we can ask whether there are some Crofton type formulas. First I want to say something about Hardeker type theorem on space forms. And this is the following theorem, which says that whenever we have such a space form, so pseudosphere or pseudo-hyperbolic space or pseudo-Euclidean space, then the space of isometry invariant generalized valuations is again spanned by the intrinsic volumes and their complex conjugates, or by real and imaginary parts of intrinsic volumes. So that's a version of Hardeker's theorem on these pseudo-Riemannian space forms. I should remark here that if instead of generalized valuations, we look at continuous valuations, then there's no such theorem on spheres and hyperbolic spaces. So even in the Riemannian case, this is an open problem. So of course it is conjectured that the intrinsic volumes are the only such valuations, but this is an open problem. Okay. Now we can try to formulate Crofton formulas. But as you can expect, there are some technical problems again. So we take a pseudo-Euclidean space, pseudo-sphere, or pseudo-hyperbolic space, Mn sigma. And since the problem is that there is no invariant measure on the space of totally geodesic submanifolds. So if I say there's no invariant, then I mean in general. So there may be some cases like Riemannian case where there are, but in general, there is no invariant measure. So what should we do? Well, what we can do is we take, instead of measures, we just take generalized measures, or also called distributions. And then it is not easy to construct such invariant generalized measures. Let me just sketch how we construct them. So first we take a compatible Riemannian metric. So compatible means that the Riemannian metric and the pseudo-Riemannian metric, they should not differ too much. So basically what you can do if you have the metric from before, where some signs are plus, some signs are minus, just switch the minus sign to plus signs and then you obtain a Riemannian metric. And then whenever you have totally geodesic, well, actually, this is not very precise what is written here, but so if you have a plane in some tension space, then you can look at the Cram matrix with respect to the pseudo-Riemannian metric. So you take a P orthonormal basis in the space, and then you look at the Q scalar products. So Q is a pseudo-Riemannian metric. So you will obtain some matrix, and you can take its determinant. And the determinant will have some signature. So if P is just a pseudo Riemannian metric, then this Cram matrix is not necessarily positive defined. And so we can look at parts where the where x has some fixed signature p n minus k minus p, and we define this function, so absolute value of the determinant to the power lambda. And then it is known, basically by work of Cayley and Garding, that this function, which maps lambda to this lambda's power of the determinant of x, extends to a meromorphic family of generalized measures. So this is meromorphic in lambda, and for real value of lambda large enough, this is really a usual measure. But if then the real value of lambda becomes smaller and smaller, then this will be no longer a measure, but only a generalized measure, so a distribution. So it's a meromorphic family, but it turns out by work of Muro that you can take certain linear combinations of these meromorphic generalized measures that are even analytic. So this is what is written here. So there's this analytic, there's this analytic family of generalized measures. And then the invariant generalized measure, which we construct, is just the pullback of this generalized measure evaluated at some particular point. So we take lambda minus n plus 1/2, which has a very small real value. And so at this point, it is really a generalized measure and not a usual measure. So that's the invariant measure which we use. There's some freedom here. Actually, that's not the only invariant generalized measure which there is. And it is not quite clear how many invariant measures there are. There seems to be no complete classification. But this one here has particular nice properties. So this is the one which we will use. And now comes the Crofton formula. So we take some K, which should be nice enough body. So for instance, generic domain with smooth boundary in M. And then we integrate against the Euler characteristic of the intersection with some totally geodesic submanifold E. And we integrate with respect to MK, which is a generalized measure which was defined before. And then it turns out that this can be evaluated, and the result is what is written here on the right-hand side. It is again some linear combination of intrinsic volumes of K. There's something which is a bit tricky in this formula, namely the left-hand side. In general, it is you have to work a bit to see that this is even a well-defined integral, which is written here, because this function which you integrate, this Euler characteristic, well, that's an integer-valued function, and so in particular, it will not be a smooth function, except if it is constant, and we integrate it with respect to some generalized measure, and so in general, this will not be well-defined. Except if the singularities of the generalized measure and the singularities of the function are somehow disjoint from each other. And so this is what we have to prove that this integral makes sense. And this is a lot of work to show that it really works and one can define this integral. Okay, let me give you the idea of the proof. Well, first of all, we can use Hartwiger's theorem or the Hartwiger type theorem on spheres and hyperbolic spaces to see that the left-hand side will be some linear combination of the intrinsic volumes and their complex conjugates. And then we use suitable templates to find the correct coefficients. This sounds much easier than what happens in reality. In reality, it turns out that if you do this, then there are some computations involving integrals which are very hard to compute. So in fact, we can compute these integrals only in some particular cases, basically in the Euclidean and in the Lorentz case. And then we use some tricks, namely some kind of analytic continuation to move between different signatures. So to go from Lorentz signature to other signatures, we use some other parameter and show that everything depends analytic or meromorphic on this parameter. But that's a lot of work, but at the end we find this formula. Two observations. So here is the Crofton formula again. The first is some surprising fact. So actually, me and my co-authors, we were not always very. So some of my co-authors think it's not surprising. Some think it's surprising. But okay, let me just state the observation. So if you look at these Crofton formulas, if you see the right-hand side. There is no reference to P and Q, which is the signature of the manifold. So these Crofton formulas, they are formally identical for all dimensions n, for all signatures P and Q, and all curvature sigma. So the curvature sigma only appears here, and otherwise the formula is always the same. So in whatever space you are. So This is some interesting phenomena. Let me put it like this. The second observation is that when we use the Hartwiger type theorem, then we know that the left-hand side can be expressed as some linear combination of intrinsic volumes and their complex conjugates. However, as it turns out, the complex conjugates, they do not appear on the right-hand side. We don't have a very good explanation for this. Nevertheless, it turns out that also in many other formulas, like some Künnes type formula, these intrinsic volumes seem to form some space which is closed in some sense. So in many formulas, you only see the intrinsic volumes and not the complex conjugates. And also for this, we don't have a very good explanation. Yeah, so I think this is all that I wanted to tell you. So this is based on these four papers. So the first one is published in 2017, and the others are on archive or will be soon on archive, so 2019, 20, and 21. And thank you very much for your attention.